Really aware of the infrastructure for small entrepreneurs in different fields, but in my own line, I do have a general idea as to what is available, because like I told you before that, you know, we started very small. I started off with my own money, and we had to go to banks, because when we entered the line, we found out that we were entitled to loans, packing credit, and post shipment on very good terms. But we really didn't get them, because every bank that we talked about collateral securities, and we didn't have any collateral security to offer. I mean, I told you we started so small that there was no way. I mean, if you had the kind of money for collateral security, we would have gone to the banks anyway. That's what I believe in. If you have the money, use it yourself. There's no point in paying interest, because you've got to be very, very competitive in exports. And it turned out that we were not getting any help.
Banking was a problem in the sense that it was taking too long for us to negotiate any kind of deal with them. Whenever we asked for any finances, it took almost as much as 6 to 8 months for them to decide as to whether they would like to give it to us or not. They would have to revert back to their respective headquarters and zonal offices to give us any kind of answer. And our business needs at that time were such that we needed immediate finance, which we could not, and we couldn't depend on the bank. So it had to be our own capital and whatever money we were able to generate from our own business to be plowed back into it.
Well, we haven't really invested much of finance, because we haven't bought any equipment. And it's whatever money we need has come from projects, or then we depend on the family.
The money was all from my own input. I mean, I didn't borrow it from anybody, or I didn't take a loan or something, but it was all from self-financed project, because it didn't require that time so much of money to start a modeling agency as such, you know. There's not a lot of infrastructure with modeling. So it was all input from my own pocket. And for the magazine, definitely, we initially got the first issue all from our own money. But we are definitely looking for somebody who can, maybe a bank or an institution who can, a government institution who can provide us with capital.
Look, essentially, ideally we would like easy access to finance, which is the primary factor, and a very, very conducive business atmosphere. That is, I mean, just to give you an example, when we deal with the government departments such as sales tax and income tax and excise departments, we face a lot of problems and a lot of harassment besides the problems, which unnecessarily takes up our time, which could otherwise gainfully be used in our own business.
Despite a negative attitude to the government infrastructure, and more often an ignorance about government aid available to the small entrepreneur, the small-scale sector remains a vibrant and flourishing segment of the economy. The reason can only be the benefits which accrue from small-scale enterprise. Some of the special features are: small-scale sector grows faster than the large-scale sector due to certain inherent advantages. Small-scale units can provide large employment opportunities for a given unit of investment. Small-scale units contribute to 28% of direct exports and more than 40% indirect exports of the country. Small-scale units are set up in remote and backward areas using local resources and local manpower. Owing to the large number of units, numbering around 2 million, the benefits are shared by a large number of entrepreneurs and workers. Before we underline the main policy for the small-scale sector, let us try to understand the concepts and definition of small-scale sector.
The Small Industries Development Program was launched by the Government of India in the late 1950s, and the genesis for that was found in the Industrial Policy Resolution of 1956. The intention at that time was that small industries should be separately defined with reference to investment in plant and machinery. Although some other states, some other countries have defined small scale industries with reference to the total turnover of the unit, and some other states have gone by the concept of total employment in the small scale unit, in India we specifically decided upon the concept of total, upon the concept of investment in plant and machinery, because capital is a scarce resource in our country. Now, starting from 5 lakhs in the year 1960, over the period of last 30 years, I think the overall ceiling in the small scale sector investment has gone up to 60 lakhs according to the latest definition. There are two separate concepts of small scale ancillary industries and export oriented industries in the small scale sector, in which a comparatively higher ceiling is also allowed. Major objectives for launching a program of small industries development are not different from the major objectives of our planning, of our economic development planning. For the small scale sector as such, I think I would say that the major objectives were five. One is the higher growth rate. Second is the larger employment opportunities. Third is higher exports. Fourth is a regional dispersal, and fifth would be a more equitable distribution of the benefits of growth. Well, I do not think that it would be proper to say that all these objectives have been achieved over the last 30 years, because these objectives are long-term objectives and they would continue to be the objectives of the small industry development program for another 20, 30, 40 years. But if we analyze the trends of growth of the small industry sector, I would say that we are making definite progress in that regard.
Many changes have been witnessed in the policy since the first industrial resolution was announced. With the new policy for small-scale industry being defined, what would be the major issues?
See, you are aware that the policy statement for promotion of small industries was laid on the table of the Parliament on the 6th of August. In that policy statement, a number of measures have been announced, but I think the major ones, they relate to provision of normative and timely credit to the small scale sector, support measures in marketing and exports, scheme of integrated infrastructure development in the rural and backward areas, modernization and technological upgradation in the small scale sector, equity participation up to 24% in the small scale sector by other industrial undertakings, the intention to initiate legislative measures for the promotion for prompt payment in the small scale sector and for limited partnerships, a separate package for a tiny industry, and lastly, a shift that rather than talking only in terms of small scale industries, one should also think in terms of industry related services, because these are the areas where it is perceived that in the years to come, much larger employment opportunities would flourish.
Change in emphasis over years has been evident. This has partly been brought about by the evolving of economic policies over the years. For example, the latest policy statement for small-scale industries shows significant departures.
See, the fact that we have announced a separate policy for the small-scale sector, this in itself is a departure from the past, because in earlier statements, I think it used to be a few paragraphs in the overall statement of industrial policy. But apart from the procedural aspects, I think the major areas of departure are in terms of shifts of emphasis compared to the earlier statements of policies. think would be five or six in nature. One is that compared to the earlier policy wherein we were talking in terms of grant of direct capital subsidies for development of industries in the backward areas, we are talking of the provisions of infrastructural facilities in the backward areas, which will facilitate setting up of the industries. Then in the earlier policy, we are talking of cheap and subsidized credit. As against that, we are now talking in terms of timely and adequate availability of credit on a normative basis. We have allowed an integrated growth of the small scale sector with the large and medium sector, which means that compared to the earlier philosophy of talking of these two sectors developing parallelly, we are talking of an integrated development. In the sense that we are allowing 24% equity participation by the larger units into the small scale sector. There is more emphasis in the role of the non-governmental organizations in the new policy, particularly in areas of entrepreneurship development, in areas of quality upgradation, and in areas of technical education also. But in this policy, we have also made a very specific announcement, unlike in the past, that the government would come forward with two important legislative measures, and those would relate to this provision of prompt payment for the bills of the small scale sector and also the concept of limited partnership.
Policy planning and implementation are two facets which go hand in hand. Let us look at the extent of policy implementation first.
See, a number of policy measures that have been announced in August last year have already been implemented, and others are at an advanced stage of implementation. The ones that have been implemented are
plant and machinery, enhancement of investment limit of the tiny sector to rupees 5 lakhs in plant and machinery, and inclusion of business and industry related services as small scale enterprises and treating them at par with tiny enterprises. RBI committee, appointment of a committee by RBI to look into normative and timely credit needs of the small scale industrial sector. Simplification of rules. Simplification of rules and procedures and issue of instructions removing banned list of industries, registration procedures, change in definition of women's enterprises. Formulation of schemes. Formulation of a scheme of integrated infrastructural development for the small-scale industries units in rural and backward areas. Committee for Exports. Appointment of a high-powered committee under the chairmanship of Secretary to look into the exports of the small-scale industrial sector. Tool rooms and PPDCs. Setting up of new tool rooms and PPDCs for modernization and training. New enactments. Enactment of prompt payment and limited partnership bills, which are in an advanced stage of implementation.
So far as the mechanism of implementation is concerned, the role of the Government of India is more in terms of policy formulation. Actual implementation has been the responsibility of the state governments. So far as the Government of India is concerned, the organization of small industries development, the organizational structure of the Small Industry Development Organization is a three-part one, and the details are
SIDO, the Small Industries Development Organization. It is the nodal agency for formulating, coordinating and monitoring policies and programs for promotion and development of small-scale industries in the country. The CIDL is headed by Additional Secretary and Development Commissioner of the Small Scale Industries. The CIDL comprises of field establishments, which are Small Industries Service Institutes or SISIs. The function of SISIs are dissemination of information, technical consultancy, economic and marketing studies, managerial and technical training, common facility services, etc. Two rooms or two design institutes. Their functions are assistance to entrepreneurs in tools design, manufacture of tools, jigs, fixtures, molds, etc. Providing training facilities. Product cum process development centers or PPDCs. Their main functions are product design and innovation, product improvement, process improvement and development, alternative raw materials, improved package including machinery and equipment, provide common facilities, manpower development and training. Regional testing centers or RTCs. Their main functions are provide testing facilities as per national international standards, conduct short-term training courses in testing, provide consultancy for in-house testing facilities. There are five specialized institutions under CIDL. They are Institute for Design of Electrical Measuring Instruments, IDEMI, Bombay, MISIET, Hyderabad, MISPAD, New Delhi, Integrated Training Center, Nilokheri, Electronic Service and Training Center, Ramnagar. A merger of these five institutes has been proposed. The National Small Industries Corporation, or NSIC. Its main objective is to provide institutional support for promotion of small-scale sector. Its various activities include supply of indigenous imported machinery on hire purchase, lease basis, marketing assistance, government purchase program, export of projects and products, supply indigenous and imported raw materials, development of prototype of machines and equipments, technology development, accreditation and technical training. The Small Industries Development Bank of India, or SIDBI. Its activities include strengthening of credit delivery mechanism, extension of support services to SSI, technological accreditation and modernization. SIDBI is the apex organization for refinance. State Small Industry Development Corporations function at the state level. They provide assistance in the field of raw material, machinery, marketing. Under the state government, we also have the state financial corporations. They provide term loan assistance to SSI, single window scheme introduced in May 88 for composite loans. District industries centers. Their objectives are single window service, and to provide technical and other inputs. Besides the CIDL infrastructure, we also have the non-CIDL organizations. Despite a vast infrastructure being available to the small-scale industrial sector, it seems to be beset by industrial sickness, which may be due to defaulting or frauds by one of the partners. This makes the small-scale sector all the more vulnerable.
In the policy that was announced last year, there is no specific mention of a policy for amelioration of sickness in the small scale sector. But that doesn't mean that the problem doesn't exist. In fact, the problem is a matter of concern to us, because according to the latest information available from the Reserve Bank of India, out of about over 20 lakh borrowing accounts, about 8% of the small scale industrial units, means about 2,25,000 odd, are supposed to be sick. But out of these, only around 17,000 are supposed to be potentially viable, and the government's policy is to revive only those units which are potentially viable, and not to throw the good money after that.
Now that we have understood the role played by the small-scale industrial sector, let us also view it in the perspective of the entire industrial policy.
The country is witnessing waves of change in the industrial policy setup. How do you think these changes have affected the government's thinking of small-scale sector?
If I were to summarize our new industrial policy, which was announced in July 1991, I'd do it in one sentence. It's a major departure from the era of regulation. For the first time, investor has been left free to decide where he wants to invest, what kind of machinery he wants to get, domestic or foreign, what kind of product he wants to make. So all this has generated a new climate for investment. I would also add that for years we are very, very suspicious of foreign investment. Now for the first time it has been made welcome. In 34 categories of industries, foreign equity participation up to 51% is clear automatically without any scrutiny. Even in other areas, it is allowed in suitable cases. In fact, even core areas like power, we are allowed 100% equity participation in certain cases. Then there is one thing more. It marks an end to the era of public sector domination. Now there are only 8 categories of units which are reserved for public sector, and even there we allow private investment on merits. So with all this, a new wind of change, as you say, is yes, really coming. And in this background, maybe that this is small sector we are discussing today, which was thriving on government regulation and protection till today. So one can possibly ask the question that when we are reducing our government intervention in the area of industrial production, will a small sector really be affected? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I wanted to know that, your comment on sectors, as you say, which have been thriving on regulation, will it not become more vulnerable now? We are talking about deregulation. And in that sense, can the new industrial policy be really beneficial to the small-scale sector?
The purpose or rationale behind the new industrial policy, I'm sure you're right, is industrial growth.
Mm-hmm.
We have departed from our last policy because that did not succeed. And have become really out of date, if not irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
In the present age of improvement in communications, where national boundaries have lost all meaning, we cannot assess the demand, we cannot therefore regulate the production. The markets are global, and therefore licensing has lost all meaning, and therefore we have liberalized this, that our goods have to be competitive internationally.
From what can be gathered about the new industrial policy, one can see that this liberalization is sort of an irreversible process. We are going onward on that path. Now, in that scenario, what kind of place do you envisage for the small scale sector in times to come?
As I said in the beginning, it will be impossible for any developed industry not to be dependent on the small scale sector. Nobody can produce everything, just as a country cannot be self-reliant, no industry in future will be self-reliant. So a small-scale sector is new from the era of regulation. It will really not need the protection in a growing economy. It will automatically get a place as a production. I'm talking about it as a production unit. It will automatically be there, and it will become a very, very integrated sort of thing. I mean that every production unit will be producing something itself and giving it to the smaller units for making it with lower overheads and lower capital cost and supplying it to there.
So you're essentially looking at as a feeder system to the larger industry or a complementary system to the larger industry?
In part, as I said, the small scale sector is very, very large. So part of it, when we are talking as a production unit, yes, it's a feeder to a large industry.
Mm-hmm.
Now in the area where it is essentially a local consumer market, where there are no advantages of the scale of production. Now, there is an independent, viable unit. In fact, most of the countries you will find which have developed, they have a very, very sophisticated small scale units. Here, because there is a very rigid definition of a small scale, which is modified every few years. So we talk in terms of rigid criteria, not 60 lakhs investment in small units, which cannot be true, because not 60 lakhs, what is yesterday, it was last year, cannot be next year. But basically, a small scale enterprise as such will have a very real place in any growing economy, and one need not fear for its future.
In case you think that there is a always to be a certain place, what kind of expectations do policymakers have in times to come from this important sector?
We expect this sector to be the main area for employment in non-urban areas, in the areas away from metropolitan zones. We expect this sector to be the main area of investment as far as the service sector is concerned. We expect this sector to be a cushion for the large sector, because our policy conceives of competition and therefore mortality. We talk in terms of the exit policy. We talk in terms of the rehabilitation of labor. Now, this is only the small scale which will take care of the burden and which will take care of the expansion and contractions in economy. So it will always be as a cushion to the large, efficient, competitive sector, which we hope will come as a result of our new policy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.